My name's Dave Pickering, and in 2011, I started to record conversations with people I know, from my closest friends and family to people that I hardly know at all. Conversations about their lives and their interests, their passions and their ideas, trying to find out a little bit more about who they are, and in the process of that, find out a little bit more about myself and about the world in general. It's part oral history and part autobiography through conversation. Over the years, it's been recommended by The Guardian, by Radio 5 Live, by Time Out, by the Financial Times, and just this year it won a British Podcast Award. To give you an idea of what the show's like, here are some clips from some of my most recent guests.
There's certain ways you can be for someone to support you. So you can be a victim, you can be someone who needs saving. But then when you're the one saying, okay, here's me wanting to say something, here's me being autonomous, here's me having agency, then that's not fitting in with that narrative of what a Muslim woman or a black woman or a minority should be.
And I remember I was going across London Bridge on a bus and I realised that I could stop and I realised that I could continue. And instead of looking back to somewhere deep in the past, looking for the point where I decided this was what I was going to do, I was going to right now decide.
If I was doing waitressing, if I was doing bar work, I would have to deal with guys like hitting on me and be nice and everything, because I'd either be looking to get tips or I'd be looking just to kind of keep the peace or whatever. Yeah. But like as a stripper, I'm either A, getting paid well for that labor, or I'm B, able to say, actually, I'm going to go, and they can't do anything. Right. You know what I mean?
When I spoke to my career teacher and came home, this was discouraged. Yeah, my parents said this to me, you don't need anybody's permission to be a great mathematician.
You can find Getting Better Acquainted anywhere that podcasts go to hang out with each other on the internet, including SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, and those kind of places. gettingbetteracquainted.co.uk.
Welcome to Hong Kong Confidential. I'm Jules Hannaford and I'm your host. I'm an Australian woman and I've been living in Hong Kong for many years. I'm a mother, a teacher, an author, and I want to share my wisdom and the wisdom of others with you. Thanks for joining me and I hope you enjoy the show. Skyrocketing rents and squalid conditions in shoebox apartments have pushed more people onto the streets as the number of homeless in Hong Kong hit an all-time high last year, according to an article in the South China Morning Post in January 2016. The number of homeless almost tripled over the past decade from 600 in 2004 to 1,614 in October 2015, according to a citywide headcount surveyed by 300 volunteers from five universities and four non-governmental organisations. According to the South China Morning Post, most of the homeless are male, aged between 45 and 64, and nearly half have been street sleepers for over 10 years. The irony is that more than half live in makeshift cardboard shacks under bridges and in parks in West Kowloon, with million-dollar flats and skyscrapers towering over them. Hong Kong is such a wealthy city that it's a shame that there are any homeless people in Hong Kong at all. Luckily, Hong Kong has an organisation called Impact Hong Kong, who are making a difference to the homeless people in Hong Kong. Today I'm speaking with Jeff Rotmeyer, the founder of Impact Hong Kong. Hi, Jeff. How are you today?
Very good.
Can you tell me a little bit about the work that you do with Impact Hong Kong?
Sure, yeah. Well, Impact Hong Kong is it is a charity, a new charity in Hong Kong supporting the homeless. And it started with the idea of just doing one single act a month in support of them. And it's become a humanitarian movement, really. And it's now we're on the streets serving the homeless every single night in five different locations.
When you say serving the homeless, what are you doing?
Well, we're providing them with necessary goods, food, drinks, clothing, hygiene products, etc. But really, we're doing that with the ambition of creating trust through familiarity. So the more often we're going out and visiting with these individuals, the more that they trust us and the more that they are open to creating a friendship.
What's the purpose of getting this trust and creating the friendship?
The main purpose, I guess, would be to create a path off of the streets and into a different life.
How many people do you have in your impact group going out on the streets with people, do you think?
Well, it's been a pretty amazing movement, to be honest. Quite a big number. I'd say it's roughly about 1,500 volunteers in the last year.
Wow, that's amazing. Yeah. And you started this group, did you?
That's correct.
What was the impetus for you to give back to the community and help homeless people in Hong Kong?
Well, I mean, I've been involved in charity work for a very long time in different aspects, with Down syndrome and autism and refugees. And I was introduced to the homeless issue in Hong Kong, and I saw just an opportunity to bring something new to the table, and that really started it.
How long ago did you begin Impact Hong Kong?
The first time I went out in Sham Shui Po was about 3 years ago.
When you said you used to work in other charity areas, was that in Hong Kong?
Yeah, well, I've been working with the Down syndrome and autistic community in Hong Kong for close to 11 years now. And that's pretty much every week. So I have another charity called Love 21 Foundation.
Oh, okay. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's with Down syndrome and autism and sport and nutrition. We do eight sports a week, from football to dancing to even surfing. So it's going really well.
With Impact Hong Kong, can you tell me what your kindness walks are?
Yeah, it's pretty much what the name says. We're going out and we're walking and showing kindness to people who are in need. It's really going well. Not only are we having a beautiful humanitarian movement where people can come and take their donation and put it right into the hands of the person in need, we're also seeing the ability to have really strong friendships. For example, like with Bong, you know, we met on a kindness walk, and through that, we were able to create a real friendship. And the friendship is really the glue in what makes our charity successful in being able to help people.
Bong Gabriel grew up in the Philippines in Manila. He had a happy childhood playing in the rice fields and the haystacks and riding the water buffalo. He went to a good school and he wanted to be an engineer like his father. However, his interests and his talent leaned towards becoming a musician. When he was in his early 20s, he got an agent and he moved to Hong Kong to work as a musician. This is his story.
First off, maybe about seven years ago, I developed diabetes. That was okay. I felt I could still, you know, have a healthy life, you know. Medical services in here in Hong Kong are great, you know. What happened was, about 4 or 5 years ago, I developed skin ulcers on my leg, both legs. It was very difficult to recover from them, you know. I was trying to take care of them really best I could, but they just got worse. And so until I got to the point where I couldn't walk almost, you know, which meant I couldn't get to work. I could still sing, no problem. I could play guitar, no problem. It was getting to work that was a problem. I was in pain all the time. Then so this happened over 2 years ago when I had to stop working. I thought I was just going to be like disabled for a couple of months or something like that. No, it took over 2 years for me to be able to decently get into, you know, shape enough to be able to get back to work. And then, so what happened was that 2 years of unemployment was enough, you know, for me to lose everything.
I asked Jeff why it was important to build friendships with the people that he was working with on the streets of Hong Kong.
Yeah, I think, well, the friendship is the key. Bong, for example, Bong knows that, you know, I'm his friend. This isn't just a job for me. This is a real friendship. And when he needs me, I'll be there for him. If he has a problem, he knows that he can turn to me. And that's the glue that will make this successful.
Yeah. So here I am with Tracy Duggan. Tracy, can you tell me your role at Impact Hong Kong?
Sure. I'm the part-time bookkeeper. I bank the money, I issue receipts, I keep an account of everything that we're spending, and all the walk leaders let me know when they've done it, put the money from the walks into the account, and I check it.
Oh, cool. And have you ever done any kindness walks?
I've done a couple, yes.
And can you tell me a bit about them? What do you do?
Well, we give oranges, water, bananas, mosquito coils, depending on the time of year, to the homeless. Initially, what used to happen is everybody would meet and however many people were there would give in money and we go to the supermarket. It's now more refined. And actually, we have somebody who does the purchasing first. So we organize a walk. The walk leader puts it up on Facebook, social media. There's going to be a walk, let's say, in Shamshui Po tomorrow, 7:30. People will reply on social media to say that they're coming. So we have an idea of how many. We shop accordingly. And then we all meet up. You would get a bag of oranges. I'd get tissues. Somebody else would get water. And then we would go on the walk led by the walk leader. Every homeless person would get an interaction by everybody on the walk. So, hi, I'm Julie. Here's an orange. Hi, I'm Jerry. Here's some water. So every homeless person is getting more impact from everybody else.
Can you tell me, what does it feel like to be handing out the oranges and all the stuff to the homeless people?
It's humbling. It makes you realize how lucky you are.
What's the response from them when they get their stuff?
They're extremely grateful and very friendly on the whole.
Oh, that's lovely. Thanks so much for talking to me, Tracy.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Apart from your kindness walks, in what other ways do you help the homeless in Hong Kong?
Well, we are we have a new center, which we just got the keys for.
Oh, congratulations. Yeah, thank you. That's awesome.
About 1 hour ago.
Oh, wow. Really new.
It's moving, yeah. So in the center, that'll be a very innovative place for Hong Kong and the homeless. So it'll be a place where they can come during the day. They can get new clothing. So they can get clothing that fits, that they actually like. They can try it on. They can also wash it when they're ready. We'll have food. We'll have drinks. But we'll also have a lot of programs. So we'll have English learning, we'll have sports, counseling, mentorship, but it will also be a place of employment for them. So right now we have about 8 individuals who are currently homeless, who are doing counseling with us, and they're going to be doing the counseling and then they're going to be hired to work in the center. So they're going to be working in the center, building their confidence and getting more integrated back into society. And through that, we're going to get them healthy, not just physically with good nutrition, but also mentally. And that will hopefully empower them to take the next step.
So it's almost like a little stopgap where they can work, they can build their skills, and then they're ready for the outside world.
Yes. And when they're engaged in that and working in that center, we'll also be providing them with housing. It'll be a really, really good opportunity for them, you know, like a real opportunity. But again, going back, the key in making that successful is that each of those 8 relationships are really, really going to be solely focused on that friendship and really providing, that'll be the glue.
Yeah.
That will make it successful.
It's important, isn't it?
Yeah.
So Bong, how did you become homeless in Hong Kong?
About a couple of months ago, I saw a friend near in North Point, an old friend, and it was going to be that evening was really, I'm not going to forget that evening because there was going to be a storm coming that evening. It was like, it was going to be, they predicted a signal number 10. And at that time, I was just like, I was already homeless at that time. I was walking the streets, you know, I was just roaming around Hong Kong. I mean, in North Point, sleeping in parks, you know, stuff like that.
Was this with your wife and your son?
No. Okay. What happened, we were already separated at that time.
Oh, right.
My wife had problems with her with her visa. So she was she got picked up and put to CIC. And so I was waiting. And then the whole time, I was just like roaming around. My son, in the meantime, also, I had to give him up to the social welfare people. And then, because I was not going to be able to take care of him, you know.
That must have been really difficult.
That was really, really difficult. But at the same time, I knew he was going to be okay.
Yes.
You know,
and you wanted him looked after, yeah.
So at that time, during the storm, when the storm was coming, I was all by myself already. At least both my wife and my kid was already. I knew they were going to be okay. They were not going to be in the storm. They were going to be there. At least their shelter. They're being fed, you know. And now, so I was the problem at that time. And I was like, wow, it's walking around in the marketplace in North Point when I saw this friend of mine, and he asked me, "Where do you live, man?" I said, "Nowhere." And then he said, "Really? Wow." And he suggested I go to the bridge. Okay. "What bridge?" "The footbridge," he said. Okay. So he took me to the bridge. I went with him, you know. And then when I got up the footbridge, I saw there were like makeshift shelters there that the people who lived there, the residents of the bridge, they made some little rooms and stuff like that. And so the storm was really coming up already, you know. Plywoods started flying around. Oh. He introduced me to the residents of the bridge, and none of them spoke English, and I couldn't speak a word of Cantonese either, you know. But it's amazing. They were so nice to me. They were really so nice. And they gave me this bed, just a mattress and a half tent. It was not a complete tent. It was just a half of the tent just to be able to cover my head. And so I stayed there for the rest of the evening, you know, until the storm passed. And I ended up staying on the bridge for like over 2 months.
So how many people do you think are homeless in Hong Kong? Do you have any facts and figures?
Yeah, you get numbers all the time and you have people guessing at it, but really it is just a guess. And I think it's from the government side, I think they estimate around 1,000 roughly. And, you know, but they really have no understanding, because if you really have no idea. If you go out, for example, at 8 p.m. versus 2 in the morning, if you go to like a McDonald's in North Point at 2 in the morning, you'll see 12 people sleeping there. People, a lot of the homeless are not going to their spaces until very late at night.
Why is that?
Well, I think, you know, some people don't want to be seen as, you know, as being homeless. You know, some people are in communities. Currently, Impact HK is serving in 5 communities. These are permanent spaces where they are always there. So we can always find them there.
Right. So that's like the bridge that Bong was talking about.
Exactly. So, you know, when Bong lived on that bridge, we knew that he would be there and we could build that relationship with him there. Off tangent a little bit, recently the government decided to take that bridge and clear it out.
Oh,
so they took everyone who was living on that bridge and they eliminated it. Okay. They knocked down all their shelters and they moved them off, and they never had a plan for them. They just did that.
Oh, no.
So they scattered, and some went to the park in Quarry Bay. One individual will be found in a tunnel in Happy Valley. They were just moved. Yeah, that's quite upsetting because, you know, we built relationships with those individuals.
And now you don't know we're necessarily where to find them.
Some of them we've never seen again. But luckily, in the last few weeks, they've moved back. So they're just back on the bridge, and we know them there. Now we can continue to build that trust, and hopefully there's one individual on that bridge who is already going to be seeing our counselor, and he'll be hopefully working with us soon.
Bong was living under the bridge, the only Filipino man living with a group of Chinese men. And I talked to him about how difficult it was for him to communicate with them, given that Bong doesn't speak any Cantonese.
Well, we communicated via sign language. They were so nice. They were really very giving people. I was amazed, you know, I'm really amazed.
And so would they share their things with you even though they had very little?
Yeah.
Oh, that's so nice, isn't
it? It's great. Well, and then I discovered that there were a lot of people who would go to the bridge on a regular basis, distributing food, snacks, whatever, toiletries, beddings, you know, if you need pillows and blankets. It was amazing. And I met a lot of people who used to just pass through and distribute food to the people who were homeless. It was like, wow, I had always had a bunch of food in my little room there. They gave me, finally they gave me a little room, you know, because somebody vacated it. Maybe a week after staying in the on the bridge, I met Jeff.
So what impact did meeting Jeff have on your life?
Tremendous. What they've done for me is just, it's unbelievable, you know. I couldn't believe that there were still people like that here, you know.
So kind and generous.
So kind and generous and passionately, you know, they passionately want to help people who are in need and who are especially homeless people. When I met Jeff, he'd be there on the bridge visiting me almost daily, you know.
Would he?
Yeah.
Just striking up a friendship and getting to know you.
Getting to know me, just to talk, and then...
And how did that feel? Because you must have been quite isolated living with a whole bunch of Chinese people when you didn't speak the language.
Oh, yeah. Definitely, yeah. I was really... Wow. Well, sometimes, you know, some Filipinos would pass by, but that's it, you know. They were just passing by. But with Jeff, you know, he asked me what I did. And so I told him practically everything about myself, I think. And then his face would always light up and say, okay, I got an idea, man. I got ideas. Okay, we will, you know.
And what were some of
we
got to
get you off this bridge, you know. That yeah. was what he was saying. And so I said, yeah, well, that'd be great, man. Well, and then he would lay out things for me.
Okay. What sort of suggestions would he make?
First off, he asked me if I wanted to work. Of course I wanted to work, right? Another day he came back, hey Bong, his face was so bright, and he was saying, you want to work, you want to sing for Ma for a party in somewhere in Wong Chuk Han, blah, 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 blah. I said, of course I do. And then he said, okay, I got a gig for you then.
Great.
Said, wow, that was a start of it. And then he said, do you want to teach guitar too? I said, yeah, of course, I want to teach guitar too. He said, okay, I got a student for you. So that's really great. Triggered it off and started everything. And then he was saying, like, okay, now next move we need to make is to get you off this bridge, get you an apartment, you know.
And when I ask, will you be coming back soon? You don't know, never know, cause I'm a man of many wishes. I hope my premonition misses, but what I really feel, my eyes won't let me hide, cause they always start to cry.
Is it easy to coax the people into Impact so that they can get the support?
So far, it's been quite easy. We don't force any conversation. We just build trust through being kind. These 8 individuals that we have right now that did not take any coaxing, we just simply said, what's your next step going to be? Like, do you want to work? What are you looking for? And, you know, when someone says to me that they want to work, well, I've got lots of ideas in job creation. And I think that that's something that we can work with. If you want to work, you know, we can work with you for sure.
And Hong Kong is really a place with lots of opportunity and mm-hmm. lots of people willing to support. And it's a good place to make contacts, isn't it? So yeah. I guess that you really, if you need it, can get the support from the community. Is that right?
Well, yeah. I mean, like I've told people this before I started Impact HK, I thought, you know, yeah, Hong Kong's quite a cold city, you know, people, you know, they don't hold the door open. You didn't say thank you and I held the door open for you. No, but it is quite a, you know, people think it's a pretty cold city, but this Impact HK movement has really proven just how many people in Hong Kong really, really care and how much heart there is. And that's just opened so many doors with Impact HK.
Do you have any support from the government for Impact Hong Kong, or is it purely an NGO?
Yeah, currently we have no government support. We're just brand new. Later on down the road, I'm not sure what will happen there. But right now, we're pretty much solely funded by individuals. We're pretty much an army with over, you know, well over 1,000 volunteers this year.
So wow, it's that's big, so it's a big impressive. Movement.
Yeah, it's yeah. been a really...
And it sounds like it's growing fast.
It is. It is. And with minimal effort, really. You know, I think the future of Impact HK, I think, is going to be really, really exciting. And yeah. a lot of it will go into the job creation.
Yes.
That's really our, that's one of my key, goals. That's one of my key yeah. goals is job creation. And I want to create jobs that are in giving back. So a lot of, like, for example, we're starting a painting company where individuals who are currently homeless will be painting, but they'll be able to give back. So we'll be working with seniors homes, for example, and going into seniors homes, bringing some color in and getting, you know, the mold off the walls. I've seen some pretty bad ones.
Oh, that's lovely.
We'll also
yeah.
have jobs in giving back through supporting other homeless individuals, you know, who they've walked in those shoes and they've, who better to help, who better to show kindness.
Yeah.
So we'll have lots of aspects in that, and also secondhand clothing, even in recycling. So jobs that will be aimed at giving back to Hong Kong.
I asked Bong what it felt like to finally get work and to have a place to live, thanks to the work of Jeff and the people at Impact Hong Kong.
And then one day, the gig was coming up, and I started teaching somebody already, a friend of his, and I started teaching her guitar. And then the party was coming up. Anyway, that first gig was really, I thought it was so successful. Everybody was happy. Jeff was so happy. I was really happy because I hadn't performed for like over 2 years. And that first gig, it gave me back my confidence.
That's
again.
Nice.
You know,
because
I lost that.
I'm sure you would lose your confidence.
I really lost that. I didn't lose the music, but I lost the confidence. Mm. You know, I looked like an hermit, you know. I mean, I was just in bad shape, man. But Jeff took care of all that, you know. He made an appointment for me with one of his contacts, his friends, you know, for a makeover, you know.
Oh, great. So you got your hair done.
I mean, and then things started really happening quickly, you know. And one time after that gig, which was so much fun, he came over to me again. And then he said, Bong, I found a place for you. What happened was, he said, you're going to be there tonight. Tonight you get off this bridge and you're going to go sleep in your flat for the first your
wow,
first night.
Wow, that's brilliant.
And my wife too came out of CIC and was with us and was with me. And so she was witnessing all this too. And she didn't know what was happening because everything was happening so fast. And I said, okay, this is, are we going to wake up now from this dream? Okay, and then
we
go back to the
bridge.
Afraid it wasn't
real.
You know? Okay. Yeah. And Jeff said, okay, this is where you're going to stay, man.
So do you work also with people in caged homes?
Yeah, I mean, well, I visited them. I'm working with one coffin home in North Point specifically. I really want to stay pretty much focused on the homeless at first until we eliminate that problem. Mm-hmm. No, but
do you think it's possible to eliminate that problem?
No, I don't. I don't think it will ever be possible to completely eliminate it. But I do think that we can get hundreds of people off of the streets for sure. In Hong Kong, you also have to remember that you have these coffin homes, caged homes. These are hundreds of thousands of people. And they are all on the brink of homelessness at any moment. And a lot of them will go from being homeless into a coffin home and they'll bounce back and forth as they can afford it. So these people are paying $2,000 roughly to live in a tiny box with 20 individuals in one apartment, one air conditioner, one fridge, if they're lucky.
It's not ideal, is it?
It's not. And they're unsanitary, they're inhumane, and they're unregulated. Now, if the government regulated those spaces, that would result in probably 100,000 homeless people, right? So they don't. I have a couple I'm working with right now. They were living in Victoria Park. They were sleeping in the park, and they have just raised enough money somehow to get one coffin home box. So the husband and wife are sleeping in one single box together. You know, that's $2,000 here in North Point.
That's a lot of money, isn't it?
It is.
To pay for a 6-foot by 2-foot space.
Exactly. Yeah, I have a 6'4" gentleman living in one as well right now. Well, you think about the cost, right? So with a coffin home, you don't need to pay a deposit. If you want to get an apartment in Hong Kong, you have to pay a 2-month deposit and the first month's rent plus a real estate fee. It's a huge amount of money. And until you do so, you cannot get any money from social welfare for your apartment. So it's one of those catch-22s, which is just not working. And a lot of people are really, really stuck.
Yeah, it's a no-win situation for many people, isn't it?
Yeah. And going back to your question on the numbers, I mean, the numbers have gone drastically up. 3 years ago in Sham Shui Po, when I went out there, it was roughly about 70 people we served. Currently in Sham Shui Po, there are 130 that we're averaging when we go out.
Wow, so it's doubled.
Yeah.
In 3 years.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's a serious problem. It's a very serious problem. And, you know, I think Impact HK, I think we've got our finger on the pulse of it. I think we are on the streets more than any other charity in Hong Kong. We're up there every single day. Now that when we have our center, we'll be out, we'll do 60 walks a month.
We'll
double our number. We're going to be really, really attacking the situation with kindness.
What do you think are some of the key factors that lead to someone being homeless?
Yeah, you get this question a lot as well. Like, oh, yeah, well, who are they? Is it drugs? Is it gambling? You know, is it the price of apartments in Hong Kong? Really,
illness in Bong's case.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, there's such a range. But if I were to put one single aspect as to why people become homeless, it's because of a lack of having that one friend in your life who would do anything for you, or a family member.
Yeah.
Right. For example, with myself, if my best friend in Canada was on the brink of homelessness, would I allow him to sleep in a park? Never. Right. I would let him sleep on my floor. I'd let him do anything because he's my best friend. If you have nobody that you can depend on and or nobody that you can trust in that way, then it would lead you to that situation. If you don't have that, if you have that person in your life, you would probably not become homeless because they would do anything for you. I'm lucky. I have many people in my life that would never let me be homeless.
So do I.
Right?
Yeah.
You know, and I think when the people on the street you do see, that's the one commonality amongst them. They do not have that one person who would do anything for them to do that. And you have a lot of people who judge that situation. You say, oh, but you know, they could have done this. Could have done that.
Yeah, but that's easy to say, isn't it?
It's just not the reality.
You don't know somebody's circumstances.
No,
you don't know the situation. So you shouldn't judge.
Yeah, it's difficult. And yeah, I mean, it's interesting. You know, even when they say, oh, they're too proud. He just doesn't want to ask for help. No, he doesn't have that love with that individual, that confidence or that belief or that trust to accept that. To keep going on this topic a little bit, you know, we had an individual in North Point who I presented with the opportunity of giving him a home. I knew he wasn't healthy enough to work, but I knew that his health was looking really bad. I saw it deteriorating quite a bit. And I presented him with the opportunity of giving him a free apartment for 1 year. And in that time, also building him up with some counseling and a nutritionist and stuff like that. And he denied it. And he decided that, no, he wants to live on the street. He wants to live there.
Do you know why?
Well, you know, people would guess, you know, they would say, oh, he's too proud. Jeff, some people, they just want to be homeless. They just want to be homeless. But I just don't accept that. I really think that he doesn't want to be homeless. What I offered him wasn't good enough, really.
Oh.
He did not see me as that friend that he really, really needed. He didn't have that belief in that. And that's not his fault in any way. That's not him making a, oh, he chose it. No, he just didn't see it. And that's, you know, that's a big learning point, I think, for me and in our charity. We're not going away.
To the connections, doesn't it?
We're going to keep building that trust with him. And we'll just keep presenting him with
other options.
An opportunity. Yeah. One thing for sure, he knows 100% that if he ever needs a home, that will be there for him. He knows we care about him. He just didn't have that level of connection with us. And hopefully we'll get that opportunity. Yeah, so I think with Bong, you know, we knew we had, number one, it was easier because his English is really good.
Yeah, so that helps, quite, doesn't it? Do you speak any Cantonese?
No, but luckily we have many, many Cantonese speakers.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I was lucky. As a charity, we were raw. We were too raw, honestly, to take on the situation with Bong and his wife, Brix. Mm. But because I could speak English with Bong at that time.
Did that make it easier for you to help him more swiftly?
Yeah, because we're at Impact HK at that time, we had zero employees. We had nobody who could work full time at all, right? So with Bong and I, we could communicate well. And I didn't need any help, really, in that communication process. So it was very easy. And only that, Bong, as you've seen, is extremely talented.
So talented.
So, you know, it was easy to see a path forward with Bong. You know, number one, mentally very strong, drug-free, great talent, and great person. Wanted change and had, you know, many reasons to want the change.
So an ideal candidate, really.
Really, yeah. So it was really, for our charity, it was a blessing as well in meeting Bong, you know, and for myself, of course.
I asked Bong what his advice was when people from the general public met somebody who was homeless when they were out and about around Hong Kong. What can they do to help that person?
I think, you know, just not treating them like outcasts, you know, just the people too, you know. And so maybe just if you're going to talk to them, you know, if any advice you're going to give them is just not tell them not to lose hope.
Yeah.
I think, you know, not to lose
hope. It's a big thing, isn't it? You've got to keep your hope, don't
you? Right. Yeah. And, well, you got people like Jeff and Impact, actually, who are really, they're all always on the lookout for people like this, you know, for homeless people.
What donations are most useful for homeless people and how can the members of the Hong Kong community help you?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at what I've spoken about, I think the number one donation really is just in showing people that you care. If you're talking about products, you know, water is always really, really good. Towels. I love towel donation. We work with a charity called Soap Cycling. So Soap Cycling is using hotel waste soap. They give us an unlimited amount of soap. So really, towels would go well with that. Roundtables has supported us in giving free laundry, which is very good. Food, all kinds of stuff. But really, it comes down to really just showing that you care. And we do see a lot of people really care. Not just our charity. You do see other charities out there. You see churches out there. You see really, really, it's been a real eye-opener.
And but how many people do care in Hong Kong and do try to make a difference?
It's really amazing. I'm quite impressed.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. And there's a number of schools that get involved in programs as well, which is really good, isn't it?
I've had such an outreach from schools.
Mm, coming, great, isn't it?
Yeah, contacting me. And I think that's a big part of our future is working with the schools. Mm. I think the teachers have done a great job in that. Very impressed.
How do you go about getting the homeless people off the streets in Hong Kong? After you've made this connection and you've developed the friendship.
Yeah, I think, multiple connections. Of course, we have to get them into a house. Nobody should be living outside. You know, multiple connections. So that biggest connection, of course, being the friendship. But I think we're going to have about a 10-point system in terms of multiple connections. So education, so language learning, for example, sports, nutrition for health, sense of belonging, maybe through sense of confidence, maybe in getting into the workplace again, whether that be a very, very easy job or not, the counseling, mentorship. And we're really going to focus on, you know, each individual having at least 6 of these connections in terms of rehabilitating that process. And we're not going to rush that process. We don't need to rush that process. We really need to focus on, as a charity, we don't need to have 100 people running through this program at once. We really need to focus on individual relationships. We're going to start with 8 in the center. I think it's already just been awesome in their excitement about and actually.
And the hope and the possibilities.
Oh, man, I mean, we just this week, I mean, we're so raw as a charity. It's pretty cool. But, you know, just in seeing like these 8 individuals respond so well to seeing the counselor and to going there every week, and they've got their time and they're really set on going there. Okay, every Tuesday I'm 11 o'clock, you know, Joy.
Isn't that great?
Yeah, I know, it is. It really is so exciting.
Yeah, it's so exciting, and I'm so impressed.
And finally, I ask Bong what his hopes for the future were with his wife and his son.
My hopes for the future is that, one is me and my family would get back together again, permanently. My son comes out of Bangkok and we get together again on a permanent basis. And as for my career, as for my music, I believe God wants me to, this is a gift he has given me, actually, you know. If I can get to use it to affect people, music is a very powerful tool.
Bong, if our listeners out in Hong Kong want to get in touch with you so that they can either get you to play a gig or if they want to have guitar lessons, how can they get in touch with you?
Actually, you can get in touch with Jeff. I consider him as my manager now. You know,
for life. So contact Jeff at Impact Hong Kong. Impact,
yeah.
Great. Bong, thank you so much for talking to me today and sharing your life with me. I really, really appreciate it. It's been lovely to meet you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Jeff, if people want to get in touch with Impact Hong Kong, how can they find you?
Yeah, hello@impacthk.org is my email. They can email me there or through Facebook. Right now, we're pretty much solely through Facebook.
And if people want to get involved to start with, they could join your kindness walks, can't they? And they're advertised on Facebook.
That's correct. Yeah. Yeah. That's easy.
Awesome.
Yeah, we make it quite simple.
Jeff, thank you so much for meeting with me today. Oh, I'm really impressed with all the work that you're doing, and I'll definitely be coming out and getting involved as well because you've so inspired me, and so have you, Bong. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, pleasure. Thank you.
Hong Kong Confidential is brought to you by Teresa's Turkish Towels. Teresa imports the finest 100% Turkish cotton towels that dry very quickly, making them perfect for Hong Kong's humid climate. Say goodbye to the traditional smelly and stinky towels and try the colourful and fresh selections available online or in Teresa's Wan Chai store. Use the promo code CONFIDENTIAL online or mention this podcast when you visit in person to receive $100 off your entire order when you order 2 or more towels. With 100% satisfaction guaranteed or your money back,
The only thing you've got to lose are the musty smells that permeate traditional terry towels. Visit www.hkturkish.com in order to get the address and directions to Teresa's semi-hidden location. So that brings us to the end of another Hong Kong Confidential podcast. I'm Jules Hannaford. Thanks for joining me, and I hope you'll be with me again next week. If you enjoyed today's podcast, please can you go to iTunes to rate and review it. I would really appreciate your feedback. You can email me at jules@hongkongconfidential.net, and you can find me on Facebook and Instagram at Hong Kong Confidential. If you'd like to hit me up on Twitter, it's @JulesHannaford. I would love to hear from you.